Today's date is July 14, 1996. Survivor is Katherine Sattler. Last name at birth is Rosenbaum. Interviewer is Alyssa Kotz. And it's taking place in West Bloomfield, Michigan, in the United States, in English. Today's date is July 14, 1996. My name is Alyssa Kotz, and I'm conducting an interview with Katherine Sattler in West Bloomfield, Michigan, in the United States. Okay, I'd like to begin by asking you to please say and spell your name.
My name is Katherine Sattler, K-A-T-H-E-R-I-N-E, last name S-A-T-T-L-E-R. My maiden name was Rosenbaum, R-O-S-E-N-B-A-U-M.
Okay, can you please say and spell the town in which you were born?
It was Uzhhorod, U-Z-H-O-R-O-D.
And what country was that in?
It was Czechoslovakia.
Okay, and you could you please give us your date of birth?
May 6, 27.
And how old are you?
I'm going to be 70, 69.
Okay. I'd like to begin by asking you a couple questions about your life before the war. Could you please tell me a little bit about your hometown?
My hometown was actually the capital city of, they called at that time, Podkarpatska Rus, which is Ruthenia today, because it was taken over by Russia. It was a lovely small city with a Jewish, pretty good Jewish population. My father came from a nice background, pretty good money, very nice upbringing. He went to, he actually went to the university in Berlin, and when his father died, his mother brought him back home to be in the business. And the business was actually, it wasn't here, I can't remember. It was a grocery, but a wholesale grocery, and he just had to conduct the wholesale business of it. And he married my mom. They met a long, long, long time ago. My mother was only 12 years old, and my father was 22 at that time, and she must have been a very lovely girl, and he told her that he's going to wait for her, and which he did. They got married, and we settled naturally in Uzhhorod. We lived there. And they had my brother. My brother was born in 1921, May 21st. He was the first born. My sister was the second, and I was the third. And we lived a very comfortable life. I went through school. My first 2 years of schooling was Hebrew. Like Hillel School, it was a private school because my parents wanted me to learn how to read Hebrew and speak Hebrew. And so those were my 2 years, my first 2 years in school. And then after that, they put me in public school, and I went through public school in Uzhhorod. I had a lot of relatives there. I had my aunt. I had my grandmother. My grandfather died when I was a very young child. And I had a lot of uncles, a lot of cousins. It was a pretty large family. And it was a pretty nice, prominent family at that time.
Can you tell me a little about your town or your neighborhood in Uzhhorod? Was it a Jewish neighborhood or?
No, the neighborhood was not strictly, there was no such thing as a strictly Jewish neighborhood. We had mostly Gentile neighbors, and I was brought up with with a lot of Gentile people around me. I had a lot of Jewish girlfriends also, but it was a very mixed friendship with all of them. It was a very beautiful friendship, very honest and very sincere. And I never thought that we will come to what we did. I had a very lovely young life. We were not poor. We had help in the house all the time, and we had a lovely home. And my mother was a very loving, beautiful lady that we had a lot of good times with. That we used to go Saturdays. Our Saturdays outings were going and visiting my grandmother and the family. because that's what they did at that time. Later on, when I was in high school, it was a little bit more difficult for me to get together with my my friends, because I had a lot of studying to do, and the schools were in the morning from 8 o'clock until 4 o'clock, and half day on Saturdays. And there was a lot of studying to do, which I didn't mind because I enjoyed studying. What else can I tell you about my hometown? It was just a very lovely, lovely city.
What language did you speak at home?
At home we spoke Hungarian, because when my mother and my father were born, it was Austria-Hungary, so it was Hungarian. My schooling was Czech, so I spoke both very well Czech and Hungarian.
What about the makeup of your town? Was it mostly people from Hungarian origin or Czech origin?
Actually, it was quite a mixture of different nationalities, because there were some Polish people came down to Czechoslovakia because the living was a lot easier in Czechoslovakia than it was in Poland. Not too many, but there were some. There were a lot of Russian. They called them white Russian people. And Czech, yes, the Czech people, after the First World War, they from Czechoslovakia, they came down to Ruthenia, that was Podkarpatska Rus when I was there.
Did you ever experience any anti-Semitism in your school days or before the war?
A little bit. It wasn't too bad. It really wasn't. And if it wasn't bad, I don't know, maybe they just hit it pretty well. My girlfriends were very nice to me. We got along just beautifully. I never found any anti-Semitism from them.
When you were in school and growing up, what did you have any kind of idea what you wanted to be when you grew up, or any kind of aspirations of what you wanted to do?
Yes, I wanted to be a doctor, which I never realized that's what I wanted to be a doctor, because I always liked to help people.
When did things start to change then?
It started to change when the Hungarian government took over that part of Czechoslovakia. Which was, I think, if I remember correctly, it was like in 1939 or 1940. And things started to change a little bit. We found a little more anti-Semitism around us, because the Hungarian people were very well known for that. I hate to say it, but that's the truth. I mean, they didn't like the Jews.
Did you know, prior to when the Hungarians came in, do you remember ever hearing about Hitler or things that were happening in Germany to the Jews at the time?
Yes, I did, because my mother had a brother in Nuremberg, and my father had a brother in Berlin. And we used to get letters from them, and sometimes they would come and visit us, and they would tell us what was going on. And 1938, as I recall, my mother told me that things were pretty bad in Nuremberg and also in Berlin.
Mm-hmm. Did that ever make you feel anxious or worried? Or
not me. It's interesting, because my father was supposed to come to the United States, and at that time he says, "Oh my God, Czechoslovakia is the most democratic country in all of Europe." He says, "I don't think anything will happen here. I think we're going to stay here. I don't think I want to go to the States."
And then when Germany came in and took over Czechoslovakia, is that when the Hungarians occupied your town?
Yes.
So how did your life change under Hungarian rule then?
I didn't care for it too much, as I said, because they were not as kind and as liberal and as democratic as the Czechoslovakian people were.
Were you still allowed to attend school?
The Hungarian government took over, yes, I was still going to school.
Mm-hmm. And what about your parents or your father's business?
Business was still thriving at that time until later on, uh-huh, when the German took over.
Which was when?
The German, if I remember correctly, the German came in, I think, late in 1942-43. And there was a tremendous change. I mean, the change was like night and day. And, you know, his business, naturally, they wouldn't let him keep his business. They just told him, "I give you 2 days. You have to get out of your business." And at that time, my father was had foresight, and he says, well, if I have to get out of my business, I will not be able to make a living. He took a lot of merchandise that he had in business, and middle of the night, his friend helped him to bring some things home, like a lot of he had a lot of rice and coffee and flour and sugar. And for later on, he had 40 because he said probably we won't be able to go shopping. And yeah, that's what he did. And they closed down our store.
So between, let's say, 1939 and 1942, did your life kind of basically go on as it had been, like under the Hungarian rule?
Yes, more or less, yes. Without any, no difficulties.
Did you hear anything, what was happening to the Jewish people in Poland or anything during that time? Any refugees come through?
Yes, we have, because there was a little girl that came to our town, and my mother asked her to stay with us, live with us. Her family was killed in Poland, and she played dead when they were lined up and they were shooting them. She fell down, and she played dead, and pretending she was also shot. And when everybody left, she got up and she was able to get to a little village where somebody helped her to come through the border of Poland and at that time Czechoslovakia. And she happened to come to our town, and my mother found out, and we kind of embraced her, and she came to live with us for a while.
How did your parents react to the news of what happened?
They still felt, I mean, my father still felt that it's still Czechoslovakia, it still belonged, I mean, it didn't belong at that time, but it's such a beautiful country that we shouldn't have anything to worry about, except when we got word from Germany, from our uncles.
And after you got that word, was there any discussions of trying to leave or fleeing or...
It was too late to flee. There was no way of fleeing because they kept a pretty close watch on us, so we couldn't go anywhere. By then, when the German came in, everybody had to give their names and addresses. So actually, you know, they were watching us all the time, so we weren't able to go anywhere after that.
Was it at that point that you had to wear the yellow star?
Yes, they gave everybody a yellow star. I had a star on my arm, and I had a star on my back. Yes.
How did your Christian neighbors react to first the Hungarian and then the German rule?
Some of our neighbors were rather cold. They didn't think that it's so terrible. Some of them felt that it's coming to us. And there were some that felt very bad. There were very few and far between the ones that felt that it should not happen. But most of them were rather happy to see it. I hate to say that, but that's the way things were. There were good people and there were bad people.
So tell me about your life under German rule now.
Under German rule, it was very difficult. We couldn't go anywhere. I mean, we were able to get out of the house during the day for a few hours, and that was it. And under German rule, we were not able to, we couldn't shop. We couldn't go grocery shopping. So what my father did, he had some of his people that he dealt with while he had the business, then they were living in small villages. They would come by and come into our house and says, can I help you, while the German weren't watching, can I help you with anything at all? And he says, yes, I have something we can trade. And that's exactly how we lived. We traded our merchandise that my father brought home from his business to buy milk and butter and chicken and whatever was necessary to survive on.
What was the Jewish population in your town at the time?
I really can't tell you. I really can't. I think it was like 50-50. But I couldn't give you a number. I can't tell you a number because I didn't know, and I don't know.
Did the Germans establish a ghetto in your town?
Not right away. Not right away. They did occupy our house. They told us that we have to get out. We had a pretty good sized home, and then we had to get out of most of our rooms. We had to turn over most of them. We kept the kitchen, and we kept one living room, I mean, part of the living room and a bedroom for us, for our purpose, the Sony, and they took over the rest of it.
So they were living in the house?
They were living, yes.
While you were there
with
too?
Us. Yes.
And how did they treat you?
They didn't treat us in any way at all. I mean, they just let us stay there because they knew something was coming. Sooner or later, they'll have the whole house to themselves.
How do you remember feeling at this time? Were you anxious or fearful?
Yes, I was very fearful. I was very, very fearful. I didn't know how to handle them. I didn't know how to go about talking to them. I was afraid to talk to them, and yet I spoke German at that time because we learned in school. We learned German, so I was able to communicate with them. In the beginning, it was not threatening to the point where they would shoot us or they would do any harm to us. Not for a while. No, it wasn't.
What were your parents? What was their state at this point?
I know my mother was very scared, and my father, they both were scared. They just didn't want to show it to us because they were afraid that if they're going to show us that they are scared, that we're going to panic. We might say something to the German, and that would be a very bad thing to do. So they were trying to cover up a little bit.
The Germans that were living with you, were they SS or were they the army?
No, there was the Wehrmacht. Yes, the regular German army. No, I haven't seen an SS in our town at all, not at all. They were all Wehrmachts.
So how long did that living arrangement continue then?
The living arrangement actually stayed on until we were ready to be evacuated from there, which was in a Passover time in 1944. And at that time, they gave us 2 days' notice to get your stuff, whatever you want to get together, and pack your bags then because you will be taken out of your home.
Did you have an idea where you were going to be taken?
None at all, not whatsoever.
Had you heard of places like Auschwitz or Treblinka?
Not at all. We had no idea.
Were you expecting that there would be a deportation?
No. No, we didn't. Actually, we didn't, because when they came in and they took us away from out of our house, you know, they took us into a place that it was a lumber yard. And they round up all the Jewish people in a lumber yard, and naturally the accommodations were horrid. We were there before we walked in. What happened was before they searched us to make sure that we don't have any valuables on our bodies or hidden anywhere. And if we did anything, naturally my mother handed over whatever. If she wore a ring, she had to hand it over. And they searched even the young girls, I mean, bodily. They searched them to make sure that they are not hiding any jewelry. And we were in this camp. It was a lumber yard for about a week or so. It was Passover time. And after a week, they decided to take us into another place, which was a brickyard. It was a brick factory, actually. And the buildings were made out of bricks, so, you know, we had some place to hide. And, of course, we were like 50 or 60 of us in a small place, in a very tight little quarters. And we were there for a while. And, of course, they didn't feed us, so whatever food we brought with us, which was very rational, we rationalized food. And so we lived on that. I was very lucky that one of the German soldiers that were with us came to look for us, and he brought us a bread. And he says, if you run out of it, he says, I'll be back tomorrow, which it was very nice, I mean, we appreciated it very much. I want to backtrack a little bit because I forgot to tell you something. While the Germans were with us, before they took us away, one of the soldiers came to me and says, you know, I have a friend in Budapest, and I would like to save you, and I would like to take your sister and yourself and save you from whatever is coming, which I don't know what. I can't tell you anything. He says, I'm going to hide you. I said, "Oh, I really do appreciate it, but I said, if you can take my mother and my father, I'll go. Otherwise, I won't." And that was a decision, so I didn't go. That's how we ended up in the ghetto.
So how long were you in the brick factory then?
We weren't there very long. I think we must have been there about 2 weeks. And after 2 weeks, they rounded up everybody, and I was there with my aunt, and my grandmother was with us in the same time because they lived in the same town. And they took us to the railroad station, and we didn't know why. And they told us, he says, "We are taking you to a camp where you'll be able to work. It's a working camp." So we had no idea where we were going until we got where we went.
Who was still with you of your family at this point?
At this point, my father, my mother, my sister, and myself, because my brother was taken away 2 years prior to that into a labor camp. He was a young boy, but they took him to a labor camp. All young boys were taken to a labor camp.
By the Hungarians?
By the Hungarians. Actually, by the Hungarians, but actually by the, it was the Germans who did it.
Had you heard anything from him?
No, not at all. We didn't know where he was. We had no idea whether he was alive or dead.
So they came in one day at the brick factory, rounded you all up, and took you to the train station.
Took us to a train station.
And this was in the late fall?
No, it was not. It was in the spring. It was still it was still Passover time at the time.
In 1944. I mean,
it was around Passover time in 1944. And when we saw all the cattle cars, I had a pretty good idea that this trip is not going to be the most wonderful trip they're going to take us on. And they took so many people at each time, about 80 to 100 to each cattle car. And they just put us on, they locked the doors, and that was our beginning of our beautiful journey to nowhere.
How long was your journey?
I remember we were there like two nights. And, you know, it was all locked. There were no facilities inside the car. They gave us buckets, you know, to relieve yourself if you were able to get to it. Or otherwise, they were old people, and they just did what they had to do without any help.
Any food?
Any food, no food, none whatsoever. No water, no food, just like cattle, nothing.
Could you tell what direction you were going, or do you remember any?
I couldn't tell, nobody could tell what direction, because there was no way of looking out. We couldn't look out. Whatever there was, something that we could have, it was too high up. Nobody could, you know, look that high up. It was like the cattle cars, if there is a little window that's very high up on the top, it's not in the middle.
Right. So when the train stopped and the doors opened, what did you see?
When a train stopped and the doors opened, all we saw were men with striped clothing. They were, you know, just a shirt and pants, and a lot of German soldiers, a lot of them. I mean, they were just surrounded. And all I was hearing for them to say, "Mach schnell," to get off the cattle car. So we jumped off, you know, right away. I mean, we didn't take anything with us because they told us, "Don't take anything with you. Leave everything on the train." And we did. We left everything on the train.
And then what happened?
They lined us up in the men separate and the women separate. Then what they did, the old people that were with young people went to one side. And the healthy young girls or young mothers were going to another side. One was left and one was right. And as it happened, my mother looked very young, and she was, she came with us. I kind of pulled her with me. So we lucked out. My sister, my mother, and myself were together.
What happened with everybody else you were with?
Most of the people that I was with were older people. My aunt went with my grandmother. She held her up because she was an old lady, so she went with my grandmother. There were a lot of people that I knew very well, young women with young children, went also in the same side as my grandmother and my aunt. And we had no idea where they were going to go, and we had no idea where we were going to go. And I barely had time. I looked at my father before they took him away. I mean, he walked away from where we were. And I just a glance, and he looked back, and that was the last time that I looked at him.
So at this point, you were with your mother and your...
At this point, I was with my mother and my sister. Yes.
And then what happened after that?
After that, they lined us up, and there were quite a few women. They were all young women. And we started to... they told us to follow a German woman, a German soldier. She was a soldier. And we followed her into the camp. And we ended up in a very large building. And we had no idea what this building was. And she says, you know, you don't have to be afraid because you're just going to go and take a shower and they're going to clean you. And we piled into this place. And the first thing they told us, I want you to disrobe totally and leave your shoes on, but disrobe whatever you have on. You don't want anything on. And then they took us one by one, and they shaved us from top to bottom. And they went and then lined us up to go into the shower, and they told us, leave your shoes here, you'll find them later, don't have to worry about it. And they lined us up, and sure enough, we went into a shower, and we showered, and when we came out, just as wet as we were, there were no towels available to wipe yourself. They gave you a gray, drabby, dress. It looked like a sack, and that was our dress from that on. And we found shoes. The shoes were whatever you were able to find. It was not your own shoes that you came with. Whatever you were able to find, that's what you took. So that was our indoctrination. That was the beginning of our Auschwitz stay.
Okay, why don't we pause here? This is the end of tape one.
Okay.
This is the beginning of tape number two in an interview with Katherine Sattler. Okay, when we left off, you had just come out of the shower at Auschwitz. You were given a dress and a pair of shoes. And what happened after that?
After that, we were lined up, and they were taking us to a building, a large building. And at that time, we were still with the people that we came with from my hometown. Most of them, not only hometown, but around our city. We went into this building, and it was chaos. It was total chaos. Everybody was crying and screaming. They didn't know what was happening. But I did remember one thing. I said to my mother, if somebody is going to ask us to help them to do something, I said, I'm going to volunteer. She said, don't you dare to do it. I mean, that was my mother's, don't you dare to do it. Sure enough, in a few minutes, while we were there about maybe a half hour, a German SS woman came in, and she asked who would like to help to bring in some food from the outside. They needed 25 people to help her. And my hand went up, And my mother was crying. She didn't want to go. I just pulled her with me, and I pulled my sister with me. I says, yes, we are going to help them to bring some food in because probably they're hungry, and so are we. I said, let's go. And so anyway, they took us, 25 of us, took us away. And instead of going and bringing in some food, they took us to a different place, a totally different place, a different lager. It's called the lager. They took us away from all our friends to some place where we didn't know a soul. And that was the first thing that we noticed, that don't trust them. Of course, we didn't trust them anyway. They took us into another lager. It was our lager. When we walked into this place, it was already full. There was three layers of bunk beds in this place. And there was only one small place available, which was on the very bottom. And there was no flooring. It was just the earth. And it says, this is where you're going to be sitting. And this is where you're going to be living. This is where you're going to be sleeping and living. So that was our first day in Auschwitz. Later on that day, they didn't pay any attention to us. We were just sitting. We weren't talking. We were afraid to say anything at all because we didn't know what to expect. There was one woman that's called a capo who is in charge of the that camp, that building. And I happened to talk to her, and I said to her, gee, I says, you know, when we came through, I saw some buildings that have large smokestacks. And I said, is this a factory? Are we going to be working in a factory? Or is this maybe a bakery or something? She says, yes, it is a bakery, and I want to tell you what kind. I said, oh, really? And I was very naive, and I said, what kind of bakery is it? She says, who did you come with here? I says, I came with my father and my aunt and my grandmother. And she says, well, how old was your father? And I told her how old he was, about 50. She says, and how about your grandmother? I said, my grandmother was 83. She says, well, do you see that big smokestack? She says, that's where they are going out from. And I said, what do you mean? She says, well, you know, they were killed, and they were gassed, and they were killed, and they burned them. And that's how I found out what was going on in Auschwitz. That was my first day of introduction to Auschwitz. And from then on, it was like living hell. Because early in the morning, we didn't sleep that night because nobody could sleep on the floor. I wasn't used to sleeping on earth, on a cold floor, and it was night. It wasn't summertime yet. It was still end of April. And we didn't sleep that night, and next morning we had to have, they call it Seelappel. Seelappel means you went outside and you lined up five deep. So what I did, I put my sister in the front and my mother in the middle, and I was behind, and we would take turns each day. I was in the front, my mother was always in the middle, and my sister was in the back, and to count us. And the first day, everybody was standing outside very, very early in the morning. And an SS man came around. There were quite a few, but there was one particular guy, tall, and not very tall, but he was at a very nice posture and a good-looking guy. And he would look us over and look and look, and he would select people that he didn't like. And he pulled out quite a few people. I had no idea for what until I found out later what it was for. But each morning, that's what happened. And after those people were gone, they said, you are going to be eating breakfast food. Well, food consisted of black coffee and nothing else. And the black coffee was given to us in like a saucepan, a pot, for five people. So the first one started to drink, and the second went down to the fifth. The fifth didn't have enough. I mean, it was just too bad. But that was our very first breakfast in Auschwitz. And we didn't do too much that day. They left us outside most of the day. At lunchtime, they came, and I saw a lot of people in a very bad shape around me. And for lunchtime, again, they gave us a pot with some soup. And I saw some funny things floating on the top. I had no idea what it was. But you were so hungry that you didn't care what was in that soup. If you were able to just drink a little, because there was nothing to eat in that soup at all, you did it. I mean, we ate, we drank some of it, and my mother did. I made sure that my mother had some. And that was our lunch. That was the first day. For dinner, again, they left us outside most of the time. And the first day for dinner, they told us to line up. We lined up. And they told us we're going to be fed again. And at that time, they gave us a piece of bread, a very small piece of bread. It looked like pumpernickel to me. It was like almost like a multigrain piece of very thin piece of bread and a very thin salami, one slice of salami that was like paper thin, and that was our dinner. And from after that, they locked us back into the barrack. We had to go back in a barrack. They locked us in there until next morning. And this went on for a while. And one day, and every morning when we lined up for Tselapel, I knew that somebody is going to be missing next day, and that's exactly what happened. And I tried to, every time Mengele came around, and if my mother was pale, I would go in the back and I would pinch her a little bit, and it brought a little color into her face because it hurt her. So I hurt her. And it brought a little color into her face just to make sure that they're not going to take her away from me, because she was very, very pale. And I did it every single day, day after day, to make sure that she was still with us. But I saw a lot of people being taken out of the lines, and I never saw them again until I found out later on what was happening to them. And one day, we were there maybe 2 weeks, and one day they came and they selected a few people. We didn't know for what, and I thought to myself, they're going to select us for work. I'm going to volunteer again. And naturally, it didn't go well over with my mother. She didn't like it, but I did anyway. And they came and it wasn't even that much up to me. It was up to them to select us. So they selected, thank God, the three of us. And they took us to a large barn, and we didn't know what to expect. And there were people sitting at a table with a small table, a chair and a small table, and they had a needle in their hands, and we had no idea what was the needle for, until they said, now we're going to give you a number so that we can keep, you know, we know where you are, who you are. And we had to give them our name, and then they gave us the tattoo. They tattooed us, all three of us. And I remember my mother crying, and my sister was crying very, very bitterly. And I said to them, you know something? I says, you know, don't cry that hard. I said, don't cry, because the reason that they gave you a number is probably because they're going to keep track of you. Maybe, you know, if we have a number, maybe you're going to be working, and that maybe that is a good sign. So that's kind of, you know, my mother realized that maybe I was right. And that was our first day of having a tattoo on our arms, and we got tattoos, consecutive numbers.
What numbers were they?
The numbers were 6731, 6732, and 6733, which I have 6733. Those were the numbers.
Where did they take you after that?
After that, the following day, they collected 250 women from our barrack who had the numbers, and they took us away to a different place, which happened to be called the Brezhinka. We didn't know what it was. We had no idea where we went. All we had to do is stuff some actually something for to make a bed. Excuse me. it was like a mattress, and we had to stuff it with straw. So we were stuffing these mattresses with straw, and we didn't know why. I mean, they took us every single day, so we did it. Excuse me, I'm sorry. I have frog in my throat. This went on for about 3 or 4 days. It was back and forth, and people were so jealous of us, all the rest of the people in our camp, because we were given white kerchiefs for our heads. We were bald at that point. We were all bald, naturally. And we had these kerchiefs, and we looked a little bit cleaner. And the third day, what they did, they gave us different dresses. It was my dress was a burgundy with white spots, actually, white
polka dots.
And that was my dress. And my mother got the same color, and so did my sister. So they separated us in two sections. There were some girls that were given white polka dots with a navy blue background. Ours was with a burgundy background. And each day when we were going to work we found out what was the name of that place. It was Brezhinka. And after the third or fourth day, they kept us there permanently. And that was the start of our working within a crematorium. We didn't know what we were supposed to do the first day. We were still stuffing the mattresses. And once the mattresses were all stuffed, we found out those were for us to sleep on, because we had two barracks. One was the navy blue dress barrack. One was the red dress barrack. And following day, they took us into this barrack. And the sight was and the stench was unreal. We saw clothing all the way to the ceiling. It was like a barn all the way to the ceiling. And they told us, you have to take one piece at a time and take the hemline apart and take buttons that were covered. If we saw any covered buttons, we had to take the covered buttons apart. Because what we found out, a lot of the covered buttons had gold pieces in them instead of being buttons. This is how they were hoping that they'll be able to utilize their monies. And I found out that all this clothing came from the cattle cars and from the crematorium. And this is what we started to do. We had to separate men's, women's and children's clothing. They had like handbags, leather handbags. We had to cut them open because on the bottom of a lot of the handbags, they had a lot of jewelry stuck inside. So we had to take those apart, the hemlines apart, and whatever was suspicious, whatever we thought that there could be some jewelry in, we had to take, and we found a lot of very valuable jewelry in that. And naturally, we had to put that in a box, and we had to turn it over to the German, because every day after we were through working, they came around to get all the jewelry from us. And this went on for a long, long time. I mean, many days.
Were you guarded closely by the Germans?
Very, very closely, yes. There was a guard in front of each door every single time. When we were in Brezhinka, we saw people, transports coming in. They were walking because they were walking toward the gas chamber. We were seeing people going in, never coming out. The stench was absolutely horrible because you smelled the burning flesh day and night, all the time. There was one transport that was, it stands out in my mind that hurts me very much. There were old people walking toward the gas chamber, and I happened to go at that time. I happened to go for water. I was selected to go for water. And I went for water, and this old lady was crying, water, water. And I was about to turn around and give her some water when the SS man came over to me and he slapped my face so hard that I thought I wasn't going to have a tooth left in my mouth. And I did not grant her last wish. It was very hurtful for me. It was hurting me very much. There were a lot of things happened. I was very sick at one time. I had a very high temperature. And they had an infirmary in the building, within our building, and they took me there. And I know my temperature was very, very high. And I know a lot of girls that went into that infirmary before, and I never saw them again. They took them away, and I never, ever saw them again. So what I did one day, and I was there like for 3 days, they gave me the thermometer, and I looked at the thermometer, and my temperature was very high. So before the nurse had a chance to come back and look at me again, I took the thermometer, I shook it down, and I rubbed it on the sheet and on my bed a little bit, just to the point when I felt it was safe. And when she came in, I says, "Oh," I says, "I'm sorry, I took it out before you had a chance to, you know, to come in." I said, because I had it in my mouth for an awful long time. I said, "Here, the thermometer." I said, "Do you want to see it?" She says, "Yes." And she looked at it. She says, "Oh, it looks like your temperature has gone down." She says, "But I'll have to keep you here for another day." And I did the same thing. I repeated the same process just to make sure. In the meantime, I was burning up because I had a very, very high temperature. And after the second day, they let me go out. And I went back to work with my mother and my sister. But while we were standing in Salapel, I passed out from the high temperature, I guess. And my sister caught me because I was falling back. She caught me, and she caught me just on time as the German passed our Salapel. He counted us, and he went right past me, and that's when I passed out. So that was my luck. Otherwise, I would not be here to tell you this story.
What were your relations with the other prisoners?
It was very beautiful, very nice. We were just friends. We helped each other. Anybody that needed some help, we did. In fact, there was one little girl who was all by herself. We took her with us, and we helped her as much as possible because the food was a lot better than it was in the A-Lager, because I guess we needed a little more energy to work, so they treated us a little bit better. And I forgot to tell you that each day after work, they took us to the shower. We had to take a shower because they were afraid of any, because we got in touch with so many, we handled so many different clothing and were a lot of germs, so they took us to take a shower every single day. So that was a big plus for us as far as we were concerned.
Okay, when you mentioned Brezhinka, yes. That was still in the Birkenau complex, correct?
Yes, it is.
And that, do you think, is that what the other prisoners referred to as Canada? Because it was of all the valuables that were sorted and kept
Yeah,
there?
The Canada was where people would come in from other lagers and take the clothing that we bundled up. We made it into a bundle, and they would take it out. And supposedly they took all that clothing into Germany to use it for whatever they were going to use it for. I don't know, but that's what we did for a while. Yes, for a long time. Mm-hmm. We had to make bundles, and one day I was assigned to go to a heap of eyeglasses. I mean, the eyeglasses were like in a mound. I mean, huge. There was separate eyeglasses. There were shoes, and there was hair. There was everything. And they asked me to select certain eyeglasses, which I started to do. And I guess I didn't do a very good job of it, because they came and they smacked me across my face so bad, because I wasn't doing a good job. I couldn't go dig deep enough to get each sunglass separately, you know, to make it look perfect, because those were not perfect eyeglasses, and that's what they expected of me, to find perfect eyeglasses. So I went back. I was lucky that I went back to work with my mother and my sister. Then one day, again, I wasn't feeling good, and my sister decided to help me out because I was weak. And as we were working in our building, we found some potatoes that were, you know, brought in from the cattle cars between the clothing. So I went, and she says to me, "You know something, I'm going to cook some potatoes for you." I said, "Well," I said, "if you want to." That was a very dangerous thing to do because I didn't know how she was going to do it. So we found some pots and pans in between everything that they took off the cattle cars. And she says, "I'm going to try to help you." She took the potato and somehow she made a makeshift little oven or a stove, and she found some candles and she started to cook a potato for me. And a German SS happened to walk into our barrack just at that moment. And that was the worst thing that she could have done because they took her outside. They shaved her head again. They beat her up very, very badly. And they made her kneel down on gravel, on very sharp, sharp gravel. From early morning on until 6, 7 o'clock that night, without any food, without any water, they didn't give her anything. And she was still lucky because a lot of people were shut right there on the spot, and she was not. I don't know why, because maybe she was blonde and blue eyes, and they tried to spare her. But she did that for me, and I was forever grateful to her for that. She suffered an awful lot because of me. She did a lot of things for me that she should not have done.
Did you ever, if you ever found any valuables, were you ever able to smuggle them out to use to buy food or?
There was no place to go. We just stayed in that small compound. We didn't go anywhere. We went from our barrack where we lived, where we stayed, into the barrack where we worked, and to the shower and back into our place where we lived. No.
Mm-mm. So you had no contact?
Nothing. Never. No. No. Mm-mm. No. We had to turn everything over. But I don't know if I told you that I took some of the very valuables and I buried it in the ground because I didn't want the Germans to have everything because we found an awful lot of valuables. A lot of valuables. And there was one German Oberscharfer that for some reason must have taken liking to my mother and the two of us because they weren't supposed to know that we were related. And he somehow had a funny feeling that we were standing always together, that we might be related somehow. So one day he came by and he looked at us and he says, "Oh, mother with the two daughters." And my mother said, "Yes." Because she couldn't lie. She wasn't supposed to lie. If she would have lied, if she would have said no, not mother with her two daughters, then it would have been a very bad thing because I know somebody, it happened to somebody who lied and they were taken away and never seen again. So that was one of the good things that happened to us in that compound in Brzezinka.
So he just walked away?
He didn't do anything. He didn't do anything.
Were there male prisoners there with you as well?
No.
Or only female?
No male prisoners at all. No, not within our compound, no. The only male prisoners we saw were the prisoners that came in, it's called the Scheißkommando, which means they were cleaning the latrines. So they would come in with a wagon and clean it out, and those were the only men that, you know, we ever saw really in our compound within Brzezinka, where we were anyway. That's how I found my cousin. One day, the Scheiss commando was coming through, and I looked at him. I was peeking out, and I wasn't supposed to, but I was peeking out because the guard happened to walk away from our door, and I was peeking out, and there was a young boy, and I looked at him, and it was my cousin, and I found him there. And I was able to help him. He needed shoes. I looked at him. I never talked to him because we weren't allowed naturally. And I saw that he needed a pair of shoes. So where we were able to find a lot of shoes where we were working. So I hid a pair of shoes for him. And one day I said to my guard, I said, I have to go. Do you mind? I said, I have to go. Because we had no facilities, and there was just one facility not too far from us. And as my cousin was walking by, as they were coming with a Scheiss commando, I had the pair of shoes under my dress, and I was holding it very close to my body, and I was walking by him. I said to him very quickly, a pair of shoes, and I dropped it, and he picked it up. And that's how he got a pair of shoes for me. In Auschwitz, which was very unusual.
It was very risky for you.
Yes, very risky. But I had to do it because I couldn't watch him walk around with shoes that have no soles. His toes were sticking out, so I felt sorry for him, and I had to help him. It was the only way for me to help him.
How long were you in this Brzezinka complex?
In Brzezinka, we were there until January 18th. Of 1945. But before that, I have to tell you the things that we were lined up a few times. You see, when you are in Brzezinka, in that particular place, we saw too much, we heard too much, and we weren't supposed to get out of there alive. We knew it, that we were not going to be getting out of there alive. So one day we were lined up, and I said goodbye to my mother, and I said goodbye to my sister and to my friends that I loved. And as we were standing there and waiting to be taken away, all of a sudden an order came in again, going back into the barracks. Why? Because another transport was coming, and they needed our help again. So we turned around, and we went back to work some more and find some more clothing, and I found an infant, a dead infant, between the clothing in our barrack. And that was a terrible shock to me, because it was a horrible, I remember my relatives, and they had babies, and I thought to myself, this could have been one of them. But I know that they went away too. I mean, they were killed too with my aunts and my cousins and my uncles who looked old.
Okay, let's pause here. This is the end of tape number two. This is the beginning of tape number three in an interview with Katherine Sattler. Okay, would you like to tell us anything more about Brzezinka?
Yeah, Brzezinka, yes. In Brzezinka, the Germans were trying to prove the world that we were treated so wonderfully. So once in a while, maybe every 2 weeks, they put on a entertainment. They emptied one of the barracks a little bit, and they put chairs there, and they put a stage, and they brought in some very prominent, I don't know their names, some very talented people. Some of them were singers, some of them were musicians, and they put on a beautiful show. And while they were putting on the show, we had to applaud naturally, we had to smile, and we had to say, yay, it's wonderful. They were performing, we had performers, they were fabulous. We had some singers, they were just, I'm sure that they were in the most wonderful back home. They were very prominent singers and musicians. They had some violin players, they were absolutely fabulous. So they were entertaining us for about an hour. And while they were entertaining us, they were taping us. And they told us they're going to show everybody what a wonderful time we have in Auschwitz, that not all that they hear is true.
But weren't your head shaved?
Yes.
So couldn't they be able to see that on film?
Definitely.
Don't you think they would wonder, like, why do all these women have their heads shaved?
Well, I'm sure they have probably, whatever they told them, they must have given them a pretty good reason while our heads were shaved, probably for cleanliness. None other than that. That was the main reason, probably. I mean, I don't know, but that's what it was. And this happened many times over. And every time they said, all right, here are the musicians. You're going to be entertained again. Now, remember, we want a very pretty smile on everybody's face, which we had to do, because if we wouldn't have done it, then the consequences would have been not very, very nice. Also, there was one day, it was at night, and we heard a lot of crying, and I happened to go to the door, which I wasn't supposed to, but it was dark, and I snuck to the door, and it had a small window, and I looked through, and I saw transports coming in by the busloads, and they were all gypsies. Now, there were young people, there were old people, their babies, there were all kinds. They were not spared at all, because whoever was on that truck went straight into the gas chamber. Never saw them again. And this happened over and over again. There was a transport of young people. I don't know where they came from. They were already in a camp. There was one camp with young people. There was one day when we saw them, actually, we were outside because it was like sail uphill time, and the trucks were coming by because it was within a distance where we could see, because the crematorium was not too far from us. It was like practically in our backyard. And we saw these trucks coming, and I looked over, and there were young children, young, probably very healthy, beautiful children. They were taken into the gas chamber and gassed. Innocent children who did absolutely nothing to deserve it. And this went on for a long time, from different parts of the camp. They were always coming in with truckloads of people, sick people, healthy people. They didn't like the looks of them. They just took them out. That's how Mengele selected their people, because that's what they did. If there was a blemish on somebody's body, the many times we were there naked, he wanted to see us naked to make sure that, you know, there's not going to be any sickness. And if he found any blemish on anybody's body, he took them out, and that was the end of them. Like in the In a shower, that was very, very degrading. When you took a shower, the German soldiers with the SS were there, right there, looking at us. And they had a stick. They all had one stick, and they were walking around, they were touching everybody while they were taking a shower. And this went on and on every single day, day after day. This is what they were doing. That's how they got their pleasures out of it.
Did any of this affect your belief in God at all, or
yes,
your religion?
Yes. We were questioning God. We were my mother questioned him more than I did. She says, how can God watch this? How can he let this happen? Because the very first thing, I'm going back when it started, the very first thing we did, we saw when we went into the ghetto, I'm going back just for a few seconds, there was a very, very religious man that my mother knew very, very well who stood there, and the soldiers, that wasn't even the SS, it was the Wehrmacht, they had a pair of scissors and they were cutting his beard and they were cutting his hair. And this is what, you know, this is what happened, and it was very, very degrading. And they did a lot of degrading things, and my mother says, so where is God? Where is he hiding? On his way, is he letting us suffer? And the sad thing was that more religious the person was, the faster they went into the gas chamber. They were lined up the first. You saw men with beards. They were the first ones lined up in going into the gas chamber. We saw them. So this is what was happening all the time. And there was a uprising one day in the crematorium. And we were hiding. A man that was working in the crematorium couldn't take it any longer. And I guess they blew up part of the crematorium. There was toward the very, very end, which was wonderful. I wish they would have done it before. And one of them jumped over the fence, and they came over to us, and we hid them. I mean, you know, we hid them in our barrack because we had a lot of clothing there that we were supposed to sort. And it was all the way up to the ceiling, so we kind of made room for him, and he was hiding in between. And they came to us, and then they said, if we know somebody is here, and if you don't tell us, who is here? Who are you hiding? Everybody's going to be shot. So there was only a threat, thank God, because nobody said a word. But he heard, this man heard what the German, what this SS told us, and he came out on his own accord. He walked out. What happened to him, I haven't got the slightest idea. I don't know. I don't know what happened to him.
Weren't those people hung publicly?
Oh, many of them were hung publicly. We didn't see them because we were not in the place where we could see it. But I have heard from my friends who have survived it that, there were public hangings out in the open to see what can happen to somebody. Definitely. Definitely.
Wow.
And we can still smile. We are here, we can smile about it. A lot of things that happened on Brezhinka that were very, very mean. I mean, it was mean to the point where you thought, why is this happening to us? And yet, we felt very lucky to be there. That all those months that everybody was in the camp, in a very bad camp, like they call it C-lager and A-lager, and they were very, very bad lagers. And those girls and men were suffering. I mean, they were treated very badly, and they weren't fed. And here we were in a very special place, but we saw too much and was hurting us too much. And that was maybe more hurtful than being punished bodily.
So what do you think kept you going through these times, those times?
What kept us going? Faith. I said to my mother, we'll get out of here somehow. And after a while, when we started to see the Molotov, at that time they called Molotov cocktails, the Russians were bombing, I guess, around where we were, you know, not Auschwitz itself, but because there were factories around us. And they start to bomb, and then we saw them, and we were so happy. One day, I never forget, there was the sirens went on because they were bombing all over. And I didn't care what is going to happen. I ran outside, and I looked up in the sky, and I started to laugh. And an SS man caught me. And he took his stick and he hit me over my face. So I had a line on my face for a long time. But I was happy to see that somebody's trying to help us, because I knew if somebody is going to help us, it must be the Russians. So that was what was happening. It was happening a lot until January 18th.
And what happened then?
January 18th, they told us they're going to line us up. They didn't tell us what is going to happen. They lined us up. And they said, don't take anything with you because there's nothing for you to take with you. But it says, if you want to take, it was cold. So I had a men's jacket, like a three-quarter length jacket. And I didn't have a belt, but I had a rope. So I tied it around my waist, and I said that should kind of keep me a little bit warmer than not having anything. And they lined us up, and all of a sudden they said, let's walk. And while we were walking, I saw the German, the SS men, taking books and papers, and they were throwing it in the, and they were burning them. There was a big pile, and they started to burn everything that they could get hold of. And I said to my mother, this is wonderful. They're going to take us out of here. I said, we're going to be liberated now. I said, they're getting us out of Auschwitz probably, because they, look at that. I said, they're burning all those books and all those papers. They don't want anybody to know what was happening. So that's when we kind of thought that, you know, something is going to happen to us better than Auschwitz. Little did we know that we were going on a very long journey. They didn't give us any food. We went out of Auschwitz naturally, and we started to walk, and we were walking. We walked kilometers and kilometers, and all of a sudden we start to see dead bodies all over the place, because when somebody couldn't walk anymore, they tied their hands behind them, they made them bend down, and they shot them in the back of their heads, so they just killed them on a spot. And I said to my mother, I don't like what I see. I said, there are too many dead bodies all over the place. And I said, I don't know how far are they going to take us. And it was January 18th, and it was snowing, it was cold, and it was very, very uncomfortable to walk when you didn't have any hose on, just a pair of shoes, hardly any underwear on, and, you know, just a very skinny little dress and a jacket. But we had to do it, and then we were walking, and then it was nighttime, and they took us into a barn. It was a place where people in a small little village, and they took us into this barn, and there was an awful lot, a lot of straw on one side. And I said to my mother, you know what I'm going to do? I said, I'm going to hide in between the straw. I'm going to bury myself in the straw, until I saw a German come with a pitchfork, and he was putting the pitchfork into the straw, hoping to find somebody there. And I said to my mother, I guess this is a bad idea. So anyway, we slept there. It was we slept there overnight. And we walked with German shepherds. The German shepherds were watching us just as well as the German soldiers were watching us. Next day, again, we got up. No food, no nothing. I went and I kind of brushed the snow aside, and there was grass underneath. I picked a few pieces of grass, and I started to eat grass. And I said to my mother, you know, this is better than nothing. I said, let's have a little snow. Let's eat a little snow and some grass that we find. So that's what we did. Not a whole lot, just a little, just to get something into our bodies. And then we were walking again. We started to walk again, and we came to another place. We were very tired. we stopped because one of the German soldiers told us that their dogs are tired. So they had to take a rest. And it was very, very, very cold. We came into a small place, and they had a well where they take water out from, you know, and it had a ledge. There was brick ledge all the way around. And I said to my mother, I'm awfully tired. I want to sit down, and I just want to sleep just a little bit while we are waiting. So I sat down, and my sister sat down, and I almost dozed off, and my mother came around, and she started to slap my face. She says, you can't do it. You can't do it. I don't want you to sleep, because if you would be sleeping, you would freeze to death. I don't want you to do that. She kept me up. While we were sitting there, she wouldn't let me sleep. So that went on for a while, about in 2 hours or so. And then they lined us up again, and we started to walk. And we saw German ladies from the villages. They had something underneath their scarf. They had a shawl. And they had something on their shawl. And one lady came close to me, and she had a bread. And she says to me, take it, quickly, take it. So I took a piece of bread, one piece for me, one for somebody else. She gave it to somebody else too. She says, take it, and I took it. And that saved our lives because I was able to give a piece to my mother, and I was able to give a piece to my sister. It was a small piece of bread, but nevertheless, it was a piece of bread. It was life for us. That saved our life. And that I felt that. That gave us a little more strength. And I think we must have been very close to Ravensburg. We were walking. My mother couldn't walk anymore. She was so weak. So my sister and I started to carry her. And I said, Mother, you have to walk a little more. And so we were dragging her because I didn't want them to come around and tell her, if you can't walk, you have to kneel down and we'll shoot you right here on the spot. And just as my mother was not able to walk anymore when she was so very, very weak, we came to a train station, and they put us on a train, and it was a ride maybe a half hour or so, and we arrived in Ravensbrück. And Ravensbrück was one of the most horror camps that I found out that it was. When they took us into Ravensbrück, I never heard of it. I didn't know where we were. When we walked in, they said, you know where you are? We said, no. I said, this is Ravensbrück, and you better behave. They took us into a barrack. Again, they gave us a spot for, the barracks were like bunk beds. Again, on a very, very bottom of the bunk beds on earth. And it says, this is your spot, and that's where you stay. And they came around, they wanted that, and we would say lapel. And they took us out for standing say lapel again, which means, in fives, they had to count how many people were there. And they brought us some food, and only one dish. And they gave us a dish for my mother, my sister, and myself, and another girl that was with us. And as I was holding the dish, a woman ran by me. She grabbed the dish and ran away with it. And I found out that this woman was a Russian woman. She was not Jewish. And she was in the same camp as I was in. And they must have been very hungry naturally like we were. So she got to the point where she was so hungry that she just ran by and she took my food away. And let me tell you, from then on, I sure cherish, if I got a piece of bread, if I ever got a piece of bread, I hid it in under my coat. I wouldn't let anybody to see it because they would steal it. They stole everything from us. And because they were so hungry because they must have been long, I don't know how long they were there, but they must have been there a long time. They were very mean to us. They hit us. They beat us. They kicked us. It was just a very horrible camp. As she says to me, if you're going to say anything to the capo, she says, they're not going to find you tomorrow morning alive. So I was afraid to say anything. Nobody said anything. until we were there not too long, thank God. We were there maybe 4 days. And after 4 days, again, they lined us up, but we are taking you someplace else. So again, we started to walk out of the camp. And I said to my mother, nothing can be worse than this. I said, wherever we'll go, maybe it's going to be a little bit better. I said, each time it's better. Maybe this was better than Auschwitz. Maybe not. But maybe if they're going to take us out of Ravensbrück, maybe it's going to be a little bit better. They took us out of Ravensbrück. We start to walk. Again, we went to the train station. And we were walking. We didn't know. We were walking a pretty good distance. They put us on the train station, and we ended up in Neustadt, Glewe. And that was the camp that we were liberated from. And when we arrived to Neustadt, Glewe, they put us into a building that was not barrack, like a barrack. It was a wood-structured building. And they put us in one room. There were no bunk beds. It was just one huge room. Huge. It wasn't huge. We thought it was big, but it wasn't big, because we were like 60 of us in one room. And the only place, the only way you were able to sleep, if you sat down and you pulled up your legs to your chin and sleep that way, because you could not stretch out and go to sleep. And that was another camp. It was, I don't know whether they didn't have a crematorium there. But it was not the best of camps to start with.
Out of all the people that you started off with in Auschwitz, how many made it to the Neustadt Glewe?
We was, as it happened, in not too many, because the ones that I knew, it was only my mother and my sister and one other person that I knew that ended up, because they selected in Ravensbrück, they selected people randomly. So I didn't know where the other people went, because they told us this is where you're going to sleep, and they taken the other ones in different barracks in different parts of Ravensbrück. So I don't know what happened to them from that on. But I know, you know, when they lined us up with people that were already in Ravensbrück for a while, because whoever came with us didn't look familiar to us at all. It was, but we're still very lucky to be with my mother and my sister. So we ended up in Neustadt Glewe with my mother and my sister and one other person that I know. There were the four of us.
And when were you liberated then?
We were liberated from Neustadt Glewe. We were liberated May 3rd of that year. When we got to Neustadt Glewe, they told us we're going to be working, which was fine. I felt, you know, working is okay. So we, all of us, when in the meantime, by the time we went to Neustadt Glewe, my sister was very weak, lost an awful lot of weight. My mother was very, very weak and also lost an awful lot of weight. So they couldn't really put in a good day's work. And the very first job we had was dig trenches. And they told us how long and how wide. And we start to dig trenches. And it was hard work. But I was the strongest of us three. And I dug, and I finished what I was supposed to do. And then I went over and I helped my mother and my sister. Because when we went out to dig trenches, there weren't that many SS officers with us. It was mostly Wehrmacht, you know, from the regular German army. And I got lucky because one of the Wehrmacht that was watching me dig the trench came over and started to talk to me. And he says to me, "Where are you from?" I says, "I'm from Czechoslovakia." He says, "Oh, I'm from Yugoslavia." He says, "Oh, well, then we are not too far from each other." I said, "That's right." And we started talk, and he befriended me. And what he did for me, he says to me, "Tomorrow, when you come tomorrow," he says, "would you like a baked potato?" I says, "I would love it. I would love it." So he made a baked potato for me next day, and I hid it under my coat when we went back in the camp. Now, that went on for a few days. After about a week or so, my mother got really very, very weak, and my sister, and I begged them. I begged whoever was in charge. There was a lady who was in charge. I begged them to leave my mother and my sister behind, and I'm going to do their work for them. If they, you know, if I have to dig more trenches, I'll be more than happy to just leave them behind because they can't walk anymore. And she was nice enough. She says, well, you have to promise, and you know, you have to prove it, that you'll be able to do the work for them. I says, yeah, I'll prove it. And they took me out, and I dug trenches, and I never stopped all day long because I had to prove it to them that I can do three people's job in one day, and I did it. And that went on for a while, and then all of a sudden, one day they lined us up, and they said, we need people to come and work on a railroad station. So I had no choice because they selected me, and I went. And we were like about 25 of us. And they selected 10 girls. And they said, you see the railroad car? Yes. This is their telephone poles on them. I says, yes. He says, I want you to take one off, and I want you to carry it to a certain distance, to a certain place. And he said, okay. We didn't know how heavy they were. Well, the 10 of us struggled a lot, but we did it. We had to do it. Otherwise, there would have been an end of us if we couldn't do it. They made us do it, and we did it. And that was that only. That was one day when we had to do that. And then the following day, we went out to the railroad station again. And by that time, my sister was really very, very sick. She was in a very bad shape. So I asked this a German soldier, I said, please do me a favor. I said, instead of just giving me a baked potato, I says, bake this potato until it's black. Make coal out of it. He said, why? He says, because I need it. So he did, and he gave it to me, and I put it under my jacket. It wasn't that big. It was a small piece. I put it under my jacket, and I took it back into the camp. I smuggled it because they were watching us very, very closely, so we don't bring any food or anything from the outside. And I broke it up into little pieces, and I said to my sister, I want you to eat this. And I said to my mother, I want you to eat some of this too. I said, because it's going to help your stomach. Because they had dysentery. They were running an awful lot. I said, I want you to eat it. And it went on for 2 days. And they got a little bit better. I didn't know it was just, I just took it out of my, I don't know, I just a trial and luck. And When we finished working on the railroad, they took us on a farm. And on a farm, we started to dig trenches. We had to dig more trenches. And as we were digging trenches, I saw a little girl in not too distant, like around the fence. She was not too far from me. She must have been maybe 5 or 6 years old. And I went over to her to talk to her. I wasn't supposed to, but I was so hungry. She was eating carrots. And I went over and I said to her, would you like to give me a piece of carrot? She says to me, du bist eine Jude. And she ran away from me. She would not share a carrot. This is how I knew that even the children in Germany knew that we were Jews.
Okay, we're going to pause here. This is the end of take three. Okay, this is the beginning of tape number four. You had just finished telling the story about the little girl who ran away from you.
Yes. I came back, and the next day, I had to go out and work again. And what was I going to do again? I was going to dig ditches again. And this time they said to my mother, you have to go. And my sister, you have to go. So I found one of the, not SS because he was not, one of the German guards. I went over to him and I says, please, I begged him to leave my mother there because she didn't have any strength. And leave my sister there because she didn't have any strength to leave him in a camp, which he did. He granted it. He says, all right, that's fine with me. Well, anyway, we went in. I said to my mother, you know something? I says, I'll give you one more day. I says, you know, we're going to be liberated soon. I says, we're going to be coming. We're going to be going back the same way we came. We're going to take the same path as we came here. We're going to go back home. And actually, my sister was a pessimist, and she was very sick, and she didn't believe me. Anyway, next day I went out, and I dug the trenches, and by that time, I guess my muscles were giving out a little bit, too. And I didn't finish the third part that I was supposed to. And they came over to me and with a bayonet, and they were going to hit me. And this soldier that I told you befriended me happened to see it. And he started to talk to them. And he talked them out of hitting me. And they let me in. Next morning, that was that day, I came back and naturally I found my mother and my sister in the same condition as I left them, very, very poor. My sister didn't stop crying. She said, I'm going to die here, I'm going to die here. Because they didn't really pay any attention to her. They didn't give her any food. I mean, she was really starving. And I kept on telling her, you're going to see, we're going to be liberated. I can hear from a distance, I hear something that is, I bet you that's the bombs. I said, they're bombing someplace around here. She says, no, no. I said, they're bombing because I can hear it, I can hear it. I found a girl, a Polish girl, who was befriended by a German soldier. And I said to her, did you hear anything, any news at all? She says, not really, but I can tell you something. She says, they're bombing all over the place here. She says, I bet you anything. She says, I heard the radio, because he let me listen to radio. We will be out of here in about 2 days. So I went back, and I said to my mother, and I swore, I said, please believe me, because I heard it. My own, yeah, I said, I heard it. We're going to be liberated. Next morning, it was like about 4 o'clock in the morning. The barrack where we were, we had windows, but of course they had the bars on all the windows. I looked out the window, and I saw a very familiar face that was one of the SS men. They were there in civilian clothes. And I said to my mother, I woke her up, I said, Mom, I said, you wouldn't believe it. I said, he's in civilian clothes. She says, I cannot believe it. Probably he's going on for a trip. I says, he's in civilian clothes. And it took me another like 15 minutes. I saw a lot of them, a lot of soldiers in civilian clothes. I said, this is it. This is the day that we're going to be liberated. And I always told my sister, we'll be liberated before my birthday, which is May 6th. That morning, early morning, they locked all the gates. They locked all our doors. We weren't able to get out of our barracks. They just locked us in. They didn't say a word, and they disappeared. And all of a sudden, in a distance, I heard Russian singing. The Russian soldiers were singing as they were coming closer to the camp. I don't think they knew what they're going to find. And they broke down the gate. And they came and they opened our door. And they said, you are free to go anywhere you want. Now, where were we going to go? You know, you're so stunned. So what are you going to do? Well, what can you do? The first thing I did, there was a building where they were keeping all the food. I said to my mother, I'm not going to bring you fatty food. I don't know why. I don't know why I said it. I said, I'm going to bring you something I'm going to go and steal. And people were just jamming that place. I had to crawl between people's legs to get a little bit closer to the food. I took two pieces of bread, two loaves of bread, and margarine that was in a block, in a square. I took one square of that, and I put it under my jacket, and I held it close to my body. And as I came out of the building, a Russian woman who was also a prisoner there got a hold of me, and she beat me down to the ground, and she stole my bread. And I said, I don't believe it, but I was lucky because one bread I had in the back of my back. One I had in the front and one I had in the back because they were big breads. So I put one in the back, one in the front, and the one she stole was in the front. I thought to myself, that's okay. I still have one bread. I still have something to eat. And I came back to the barrack, and my sister says, is it really happening? I said, it happened. I said, you are free. You want to walk out, you can walk out. She wouldn't get out of the building. I took her by her hand, and I said, come with me. I said, come with me. I want you to see this is freedom. I said, from now on, you can do anything you want. You can go anywhere you want. She says, but I'm so sick, I'm going to die. I says, not anymore. I said, you're not going to die because we're going to help you. And that was our liberation from the camp. It was the last day being a prisoner in Neustadt Glewe, which was quite an experience.
How did the Russians treat you?
Very nice. They were very kind, very generous. They gave us their food, whatever they had on their tanks. They came with cars, they came with trucks, and whatever food they had on a truck, they dispersed it between us, and they were very generous. It was very nice. It was a beautiful day. I didn't know what I was going to do next day, but it was a beautiful day. Never forget it as long as I live. To be free again was the most precious thing in the world. And I said to my mother, there is God. God is there. He's the one who did it. We are still here. We are still alive. We are still walking. We are still upright. It was a beautiful day for me and for all of us.
So what did you do the next day?
The next day, we went where the Germans used to have their barracks. We took a room that was available, and because they had a mattress. So I said to my mom, this is luxury, and you're going to sleep in bed. My sister, her bones were just skin and bone. I said, your mom are going to sleep on this bed. And I says, I don't have to. I says, because I can find another place to sleep. I said, you're going to be sleeping on a bed. So I put him in this room, and any strength I had, I got together with this other girl that I knew from before, and we start to walk toward town. I had no idea where we were going. We were just walking. And I says, wherever we'll go, I'll go in and I'll ask him for some food, whoever is going to be there. So we walked into the nearest town, and I cannot remember the name of the town, the nearest I probably. It must be Neustadt Glewe itself, the city itself. As we came to the outskirts of town, there was a building. And I walked in, and it was like a grocery store. And I walked in, and there was rice. I says, oh, my God, how wonderful. This is rice. As I was reaching to get some rice in a piece of paper that I found on the floor, I saw something shining. And I said to my friend, something is wrong. As I looked closer, they put pieces of glass in between the rice. If they, so if they couldn't have it, we couldn't have it. From there, I went and we came over to a place and I heard chicken. I says, oh my God, I said, there's chicken. Someplace there's chicken. I said, there's a barn. Let's go down to the barn. Well, we walked toward the barn and a German woman and a man came and says, you can't go anywhere. You cannot go any further than this. You better turn around and get out of here. I said to them, look, I was in the camp. I'm hungry and I would like to have something to eat. I said, do you have any food? No, we don't have any food at all for you. And they chased us out. So I went out on the street, and as it happens, a German, Russian soldier was at the door, by the fence. And I said to him in Russian, I says, they wouldn't give us any food. He says, come on, I'll help you. So he came in with us, and he said to the German, don't you dare to be in their way. They can take anything they want. Well, I went, and I found a chicken. And I tied the feet. And I went in a house and I got hold of, all I wanted was clean underwear and clean shoes, which I couldn't get because nothing fit me, and just clean clothes, period, and some food. I went and I got hold of a sheet from a bed. I pulled the sheet off the bed. I didn't know where to look for it because I didn't have the patience to go and look for it. I took a sheet off the bed and I made a... for my back, a backpack. And I put the chicken in the backpack. And I went in the kitchen, and I asked her, do you have any food here? She says, yes. And there was a bread. I took the bread, and I said, do you have anything? There was margarine. I took some margarine. And then I went down in the garden, and I needed some vegetables. I says, if my mother is going to make me chicken soup, I better have some vegetables with it. I went and I got some vegetables. And that's all I wanted. I didn't want to have jewelry. I saw people stopping people on a, Germans on the street and stripping them of their jewelry, of their rings and everything. I had no desire to do that. I just wanted to be clean, and I just wanted to eat something. So as I was walking home, all of a sudden the backpack felt very, very light. And I said to my friend, I says, I don't know. I said, why is it feeling so light? I lost the chicken. A chicken flew out of my backpack. That made me turn around, and I went back, and I started all over again, and I got again a chicken. I went back, and one of the men that was also a prisoner, or, you know, of war, and he was not a Jewish man, and I said to him, look, I cannot kill a chicken. I says, and we need this chicken to make chicken soup. Could you please help me? And he went and he helped me. He cut the chicken open for me and he cleaned it for me. And that was our very first day being liberated. It was the most beautiful thing that we lived through that one day. Of course, we didn't eat a lot because I wouldn't dare to give my sister a lot of food because she was so sick. And my mother neither, you know, just a little bit. I told her a little at a time. I don't know where I got it from at that time. I had no knowledge. I didn't know that that's all you can have is a little at a time, but I felt, you know, we haven't eaten so long, you know, rich food, we better not eat a lot of food because I saw people bending over and they were very, very sick around me. So I thought it's from the food probably. So that was my first day.
How long did you stay in Neustadt Glewe?
In Neustadt Glewe, we only stayed like 3 days because we were so anxious to get out of there and start the journey back home, which we didn't know which way to go. We had no idea where we were. I mean, you know, we found out that we were next to Hamburg. Well, I wasn't going to go to Hamburg because going back to Czechoslovakia is the opposite way. So we ask somebody which way is south to go down south, and he told us, and then we start to walk. And as we were walking, we encountered, we were like 10 of us, 10 girls. And all of a sudden in the distance, we saw Russian soldiers, Cossacks. And my mother had a horrible, horrible story to tell us about Cossacks, how, you know, they rape women, and they're very mean. So I was very apprehensive of even talking to them. They came close, and one stopped, the commander of that unit stopped and started to talk to me. And I told him, I said, Yevreka, which is, means Jewish, Jewish. And he just didn't understand what it is. Anyway, finally, he realized that we were Jewish people, and I told him, I showed him my number on my arm, and he didn't know what the number was because he never saw it before. And I couldn't explain it to him because I spoke a Russian, but not such a wonderful Russian that I was able to explain everything to him. He went and he took everybody's drink. What they have it in their, I don't know what they carry.
Canteen.
Their canteen, whatever it was. And they took away from everybody a canteen of water and gave us the water. And as I found out later on, after we were all through and I says, we are tired, we want to go in the city. He says, I'm going to go with you. And he actually walked with us to the nearest little village. And he went in and he said to the people in this village, in this building, and says, I want you to make room for these people because they're very tired and I want you to be able to give them some food. And that was my first encounter with Russians, which I don't trust them very much anyway. But he was nice. And that was the second day of being free. So people were doing good things for us. And that was the beginning of having faith in humanity again after Neustadt. Third day, we wanted to get back to Prague as fast as we can. We start to walk again, in which we were walking south, and we came upon a small city. And we saw a Red Cross, and I said, oh, there's a Red Cross someplace. So we found the Red Cross kitchen. And we walked in, and they haven't seen too many people at that time from camps yet. They had a lot of people in that city, POWs from Denmark. And from Denmark and Holland, from both places. And they put us, they said, we have a place for you to stay, which was a school that they have converted into like a little hotel, a little place to sleep. And we went into that place, and we were there not more than a couple hours. Some people were coming, men were coming in, and they said, are you one family? And I said, yes, my mother and my sister and myself. They took us under their wings. They were POWs. They were prisoners of war. And one was a doctor, one was a dentist, and one was a policeman. And they fed. They told us they're going to feed us, they're going to find us new clothes, and they're going to, we can take showers in their place, and we don't have to worry about getting food anywhere else. We don't have to go out to the Red Cross kitchen anymore. And this went on for about a week, until I found out that there is one way, some way, for us to get back to Prague. Also, they showed us the place where I can register my register for getting back into Czechoslovakia, which we did. We went down and we registered to go back to Czechoslovakia. And 2 days, there was a truck, an open truck, coming in, and they said, anybody that wants to go back to Czechoslovakia, please be here at 8 o'clock in the morning, which naturally, that was the first thing we did. We didn't sleep all night because we were so excited. We went there, and they put us on this open truck, and we drove back to Prague. It took us a while because we made a few stops, and we didn't have to worry about food because wherever we went, they gave us free food. They didn't even question it. They knew where we were coming from, so they were very generous, and they treated us very, very nicely. And that was in Germany yet.
So what happened when you got back to Prague?
When we got back to Prague, There was another, we didn't know where to go. So again, we seeked out a Red Cross kitchen to see whether we can get some food, which we did. They showed us where it was. And they told us there's another school that was converted into, for sleeping, a little hotel. And that's where we, they had cots, one after, open, actually, open space with cots. And that's where we settled down. But my sister and my mother were not feeling well. So I said to one of the ladies that was in charge, I says, my sister's not feeling good and my mother doesn't either. So she told us to go to the nearest hospital, which was not too far. Went to the near, it was set up for a hospital. Went to the nearest place and they checked my sister and checked my mother and they said, yes, they have to be hospitalized because they were really very, very sick. And they put them in a hospital and I stayed behind in this school and I lived there. I visited them naturally every day, practically every, I was there all day with them. And then my sister one day said to me, I'm going to die if I don't go home. I have to go back home to my hometown. I says, I really don't want to. She says, well, I have to because I know I'm going to die. So my mother says, if she feels that way, she says, why don't you try to get her out of the hospital and see if you can take a train and go down, because it was quite a ways from Prague to Eastern Czechoslovakia where we were. So I picked her up one day and they let her go for 2 days or 3 days. And we took the train and we went back to my hometown. And when we arrived in my hometown, I went to my house. And we couldn't go through the gate because they wouldn't let us. It was the Russian converted our house into secret police headquarters and they would not let us go through. So I went to our neighbor that we were friends with from before. My sister wanted to go back. That was the only reason that she wanted to go back, because she wanted to prove it to everybody in our town that we are still alive. So we went to our neighbor, and they gave us a space to sleep, and we stayed with them a few days. And it was lice-infected, so were we before, because in the camp we were infected with lice naturally. And we stayed there for about 2 days. And I went next door to my house and I said to him, please let me in. I said, we have an orchard down there. And I says, all the fruit is just beginning to ripen. I just would like to look around. Let me look around. He says, no, it's not yours anymore. I wouldn't let you in. And then the next day, there was another soldier guarding the gate. And I told him what I want to do. He says, don't let anybody sit. I'll let you in. So he let me in. We went in, and we had a cellar. I don't know if I told you. I didn't. Before we left Ushhorod, my father took me down into the cellar. And it was all brick-walled. And he says, you're the youngest in our family, and if anything happens to us, you'll survive whatever will happen. Which he didn't know ahead of time, actually. He took out, we had a lot of jewelry, and he took out some jewelry, and he took out a few bricks from the wall, and he showed me where, he says, I'm going to put this one here and this one. He showed me where he puts the jewelry, and he put the brick back, like, there was no sign at all that he ever touched it. So I said to my sister, I have to go down a cellar. I just have to go down. She says, no, they're going to kill you here. I said, these Russians are very tough. I says, yeah, well, let me try. So while he was guarding the gate, I snuck down into the cellar. And what I saw, it was a very unsightly thing. Every single brick was out of the wall. The floor was dug up inch by inch by inch. And somebody was there who suspected it, or who knew what was happening. Naturally, they took everything away. So I ended up with nothing, which was fine with me. It really was, my life was spared, so it didn't matter that much. Next day, we were supposed to go home, and I had to go and get a permit from the Russian government. So they were only giving out one permit. Now my sister was too sick and she couldn't go. So I didn't know what to do. So I got one permit and I gave it to my sister. And I says, you go, you get on a truck or on a bus, you go and somehow I'll get out of here. So when we went down to the train station, she got on the bus. I went on a bus with her. I said to the guy, I just want to say goodbye to my sister. I just want to go as far as the train station. I says, I'm staying behind. I don't want to go anywhere. He says, fine. So it was a Russian soldier. He says, okay. So he let me go down to the train station. And my sister got on a train. And I walked around the train like I'm pretending I was saying goodbye to her, because everybody had to have a permit to get on a train. And when he wasn't looking, he turned his back. I snuck up on the train and I sat down real quick, and I didn't sit down and nowhere near my sister. And I just sat down. And they knew how many permits they had in their hands. There was one permit short, because he was head counting heads. And he came over to me, and that came over to me. He says, somebody doesn't belong here. Who is it? You better tell me, or you're going to be in trouble. Somebody. And I pretended I didn't even hear him. I just played dead. I played dumb. And that's how I got out of back out of Czechoslovakia, from my hometown. Otherwise, I could not have gotten out of there. So that's how I got back and went back to Prague. And put my sister back in the hospital. And next day, I went back to Slovakia. I went to Budapest to look for my brother. I was had a funny feeling. I have to look for my brother. I knew my father I don't have to look for, because I found his clothes in the camp when I was sorting the clothes. I found my father's suit, so I knew where he was. I knew he was dead. When I went, anyway, I forgot my train of thought. When I went, I said to my mother, I have to go and look for Andy. Andy should be alive. Should be, she says, well, we haven't heard yet. And I was really afraid. I was afraid to find out what I would find out, that he's not alive. I went to Budapest to look for him, also on a Red Cross kitchen. Because in a Red Cross kitchen, everybody was leaving little notes on the wall, leaving names and not telephone numbers, because nobody had a telephone, addresses and where they can be reached, where can they be found. And from there, I didn't find him. I went to Slovakia, to Bratislava. And I was also, at that time, my sister, my mother decided to meet me, so they met me in Bratislava. And we had the Red Cross kitchen, and I was writing a note on the wall to see whether, you know, somebody might find my name, to let them know that I'm alive and we are alive. And as I was standing in line, there was a boy looking at me and came over to me and says, are you Andy's sister? I says, yes, I am. I'm looking for Andy. He says to me, well, don't look any further, because Andy is alive.
Okay, can we pause right here then? Okay, this is the end of tape number 4. beginning of tape number 5, an interview with Katherine Sattler. Okay, so when we left off, you're in Bratislava. A man had approached you and asked you if you were your
Andy's sister. And I said, yes. And he says, he's alive. And I said, how wonderful. And where is he? He's in Prague. He says, where is he? He's in one of the hospitals. So we went, naturally, we were thrilled. We went back to Prague. My mother and my sister went back into the hospital where they belonged at that time. And I set out early in the morning next day to try to find my brother. Now, they set up hospitals in schools, you know, temporary hospitals. And there were so many that there was no way of calling and finding out what hospital he's at. It was just absolutely impossible. But they told me what schools were converted into hospitals to go and look for it. So I set out very early in the morning, and I start to walk in Prague, this one street after the other. And I went, it was like 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and I was very exhausted, very tired. And I went to several hospitals on like within a 2-block radius. And then I came upon the last one. I figured, this is the last one. I mean, I can't walk any longer. I mean, I'm just totally exhausted. I walked in, and again, I asked, do you have anybody by the name of Andrew Rosenbaum registered? And the girl at the desk says, no, we don't. I said, okay, thank you. I walked out. And in Europe, they have the buildings very low, like the schools are situated like you can look out onto the street. It's street level. The windows are street level. So there were two windows or three windows open. The first window I walked by, it was open. I looked in and I saw two guys talking. One guy was shaved, you know, bald-headed, and the other one was talking to him. And I just walked by and I passed it up, and I looked in the other one. And I paid no attention. Then I went to the third window, and something in my mind said, start all over again, go back. I went back to the first window, and I was standing there, and they were talking, and I was standing, and I just said, Andy? And he turned around, and it was my brother. And I cannot begin to tell you the reunion that I had with him. It was unbelievable. And I walked in, and he told me what was the problem with him. He had thrombosis of the leg. He almost amputated his leg. And I said to him, gee, Andy, I says, you don't look so bad. You know, you have a nice round face. I said, why don't you ask me about Ella? And he says, I don't want to. I said, well, you should, because she's here. Well, we both cried naturally. And as I was talking to him, I wanted him to kind of quiet down a little bit. And I said to him, Andy, why don't you ask me about Anyuka, which means mother in Hungarian? He says, I don't want to. I says, Anyuka is here too. And that was the happiest day in our lives, in my brother's and in my life. And from that on, I made arrangements for the doctor to transfer my brother to the same hospital as my mother and my sister were. And they were there for a while. And one day I was in a Red Cross kitchen, because I was in a hospital, they were in a hospital. I was in a Red Cross kitchen, and my mother says, you know something, I'll go with you. If they'll let me get out of the hospital for a few hours, I will. I says, good idea. So she came with me, and we were standing in line for food at a Red Cross kitchen, and there was an American soldier, and he was kind of looking around, and he spoke a very wonderful Hungarian. And we asked him, who is he looking for? And he told us he's looking for his cousin. And we started talking to him. And my mother says, well, where are you from? He says, you mean, where do I live now? She says, yeah. I says, in Los Angeles. My mother says, in Los Angeles? I have two brothers in Los Angeles. And he says, well, do you know where they live? She says, no. I know they're naturally, I give you their names, but I don't know where they live. He says to my mother, I want you here tomorrow at the same time, which is 12 o'clock noon. I want you back in the same place at 12 o'clock, and I'm going to bring some news from your brother, hopefully. And sure enough, next day we were standing in the Red Cross kitchen, not for food anymore. We're just hoping to hear and see him. And he walks in and he says, I have good news for you. I reached both of your brothers. And they are going to send some affidavits and some letters to the American Embassy. And if you have a chance, please go down to the American Embassy and they'll give you all the instructions as to what to do from now on. And that was our beginning of getting out of Czechoslovakia into the United States. After that, we started things wrong. We registered. We were there. My brother and my brother was very sick still, was not well, but he was willing to go down to the American Embassy. We were sleeping outside the American Embassy like 3 o'clock in the morning, and because they didn't open until 8:30. We were the very first ones at the gate. We would not move for anything in the world, and we were there until they opened the gates, and we went in, and we told them why we were there, and we told them that somebody got in touch with our uncles through the Red Cross in Los Angeles, and he was going to send word about what to do and how to go about whatever he intends to do. And I registered my mother, I registered my sister and myself, and also at that time already my little cousin that I found in Auschwitz was with us. We found him in Prague, so he joined us again, and we were five of us by then, and we registered, and the Red Cross again told us if you want to have after my brother and my sister and my mother get out of the hospital, if you want to have an apartment, the only place there is in Podmokli, which is not too far from Prague. And naturally, we were thrilled. We moved to Podmokli. We were there maybe about 4 or 5 months. In the meantime, we were going into Prague to process our pictures, whatever had to be done, and the passport and all the papers that had to be taken care of. And it wasn't too far off from that time that we were able to get out of Prague and come to the United States.
Do you remember what date you arrived in the United States?
What time did we arrive to the United States?
No, what day?
What day? Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. We arrived. I'll never forget because the beautiful sight of the Statue of the Liberty, I'll always remember. We arrived July 22nd, 1946.
So you arrived in New York then?
We arrived to New York, and I have a cousin. My mother has a cousin that lives in Passaic, New Jersey, that picked us up from the dock. Thank you. From the dock, and of course I never saw them. They never saw us, but we told them we are the five of us, and they when we registered at the immigration, they asked somebody if a five member family comes through, and there are two girls, and three ladies and two boys to let them know, and that's what they did, and that's how they found us.
And then how long before you went out to California?
Well, they took us, first of all, they took us out for a wonderful dinner. I was sick like a dog on a ship anyway for 12 days. It took us 12 days. By the way, we went from Prague, we went to Göteborg, which is Sweden, because was our point of embarkation is Sweden-borg. I mean, Sweden, Göteborg. They took us to a kosher restaurant, which at that time didn't mean that much to us because we ate anything that was available in Czechoslovakia, horse meat and pork and whatever there was, we ate. Then they took us to Lake Pixkill. They had like a summer home, so they took us for there for a few days. And from there, they put us on a train from New York. And by train, we went to Los Angeles by train. It took us, I think, two nights or three nights, whatever it was. I can't remember. But I know we had a wonderful time being free and being in the United States. It was the most beautiful feeling in the world, knowing that we are free in such a beautiful land.
So what did you do when you arrived in L.A.?
In Los Angeles, my mother had her two brothers. They waited for us, and they naturally, they were thrilled to have us. And they put us up in their apartment. They gave us their apartment, and they moved away from the apartment, and we occupied their apartment. And that's where we lived for a while. I went to work right away, naturally, because we had to make a living, and I had a pretty good trade in my hand, so I knew that I'll be able to make some money and support ourselves.
And what trade was that?
I was not a dressmaker. I was in a dressmaking business. I was a designer, and I started to work for a very lovely company, and eventually I worked with Edith Head. And I had a very good job, and everybody in my family was working, except my mother. I would not let my mother work. I said, not you. Everybody else can work, not you. You don't deserve it. You have to stay home and take care of your family. And my brother had a wonderful job. He was a baker, a pastry baker. He got a fabulous job in Los Angeles, so he was making good money. My sister went to work for my uncle, who was a dress manufacturer. So my sister ended up working for my uncle. And we were there 2 years, and I met my husband, and we got married in Los Angeles, and my husband is a Detroiter, and he decided to come back home to Detroit, and I have been here ever since.
And how many children do you have
here? We have three children. We have two sons and a daughter. The oldest is a son, the middle is a daughter, and the youngest is a son.
And any grandchildren?
We have five grandchildren. My daughter has two children, a boy and a girl. My youngest son has two little girls and a boy.
Okay, then. Is there anything else you would like to add? Anything that I missed you'd like to say at the end here?
I'm thrilled to be here in the United States, and I want to thank Mr. Spielberg for giving me this opportunity to tell my story, which was, to me, it was a little bit hard to start with, but I'm glad that I did it. I want the world to know what went on before the war, during the war, and after the war. Thank you very much.
Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, Ms. Sattler, would you like to introduce your husband?
Yes, I would like to introduce my husband of 46 years. We've been married for 46 years. His name is Carl Sattler, and he's lived here most of his life in the Detroit area. And we are very happily married, and we are proud parents of three beautiful children. Thank you.
And how about a few grandchildren?
Oh, yes. And naturally, and five grandchildren.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, can you tell me what this picture is of, please?
Yes, this picture was taken at my mother's wedding, and unfortunately, all the people there are in this picture are not alive today. The first row of the ladies that you see on the picture went away in a gas chamber. They were in Auschwitz.
Do you know approximately when this picture was taken?
This was taken. My mother got married in 1920.
So. And how did you get possession of this picture?
My uncle, who lived here in Los Angeles, must have had this picture, and he turned it over to us.
Okay. Can you explain this for us, please?
Yes, this picture represents my whole family, and this was taken sometimes in the early 1930s. Also, I got this picture from my uncle in Los Angeles who had it in his possession.
Okay, so on the bottom two of your parents, when did your mother pass away?
My mother passed away here in 1987.
In America?
In America, yes.
And
my father was taken away the first day he entered Auschwitz. He died because, as I said, I found his clothes. My sister died in 1986. She's the one that was in a camp with me.
And she is behind your father in the picture?
She's behind my father.
And your brother?
And my brother lives in Los Angeles, and he's very happily married and a wonderful grandfather. This picture was taken in Ungvar, where I lived. It's called Ushorod, naturally. And this was a very beautiful synagogue, an old synagogue that was frequented naturally by my parents and myself. And it was very Orthodox. The ladies were separate on an upper level, and the men were on a bottom level. And it was a very beautifully built old synagogue. I cherished the thought that it's still existing.
It is still there?
Mm-hmm. This was taken in Prague at the Red Cross kitchen, where my mother naturally had her meals from, and my brother. That was during the time when he was very sick and my mother was very sick. They just got together one day just to have some fun out of the hospital.
Do you know who took this picture?
I have no idea. I don't even know how it got to me. This picture was taken of my mother, my sister, and myself showing our consecutive tattoos. My sister's number was 6731, my mother 6732, and mine is 6733. My sister was the one who insisted on taking a picture because she felt that it was very important for us to show the world. This shows my tattoo on my arm, which is A6733, and that's my tattoo that I got in Auschwitz.
What does the A stand for? Do you know?
I have no idea what the A stands for. A stands for probably the A-Lager, because that's what we were in, a lager, A-Lager. And I just want to show everybody that, yes, it did really exist.
Okay, can you describe this?
This was taken at my youngest brother's wedding, and from left to right, it's my youngest brother, Ronald, and my husband, Carl Sattler. I'm in the middle. My daughter, Janice Fried, and my son, Howard Sattler.
Right, this is at your youngest son's wedding.
This was at my youngest son's wedding.
Okay.
The one that is on the right side, on the left side.
Okay.
This is my youngest granddaughter. Her name is Courtney Sattler, and she is quite a little gal.
How old is she now?
She, right on this picture, she was 2.5 years old. But today she is 4 years old.
Okay.
This is my granddaughter. Her name is Ashley Sattler, and she is the second child of my son's, youngest son's. She's quite a little gal, a very pretty little girl. We love her dearly.
How old is she now?
Now she is 6 years old. This is my little grandson. His name is Joshua Sattler. Today he is 9 years old, and he belongs to Ronald Sattler. He's quite a little guy. On the left side is my granddaughter, Erin Freed. She belongs to my daughter, Janice Freed. On the right side is David Freed. And Erin is 10 years old, and David is 8 years old. And they're quite wonderful children.
This is the end of the videotaping session. We used 5 tapes.